And so I need you to understand now that we do not celebrate Halloween. We do not celebrate it because it is not a day that the Lord has ordained. This is the Apostle Ellie Anderson inviting you now to the word of the Lord for today. And that word begins with this announcement that it is a time of preparation for the end times. Let me say that again. It is a time for preparation for the end time. If you don't understand that, we're living in the last days,
Yes.
and we need to know that if there's a time now to keep alert with preparation in 2022. Keeping alert with preparation in 2022. Listen to me today. When we look at the word preparation, we find that it has been defined as a proceeding, a measure, a provision by which one prepares for something, any proceeding, experience, or the like considered as a mode of preparing for the future, an act of preparing, a state of being prepared. And what I want you to do today is listen to me very carefully as we look at what is happening in the world today and how man is moving in the wrong direction and how we need to know the word of God for ourselves in order to move into that place of obedience. Listen to me. This is a statement on the end time. This is a statement on the end time. The end time or end of days are eschatological writings in the Bible that is described in both the Old and the New Testament. In Christianity, the end times are often depicted as a time of tribulation that precedes the second coming of the Savior and Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus, the Messiah, the anointed one of the Father, who came to earth to save mankind, which include the nation of Israel first and then the Gentiles, according to John 3 and 16 in the Amplified, says, "For God so greatly loved and dearly prized the world that he even gave up his only begotten unique Son, so that whosoever believes in, trusts in, clings to, relies on him shall not perish, come to destruction, be lost, but have eternal and everlasting life." And what I want you to understand today is that the messages that we have been preaching, the times we have been teaching, is to bring you into a closer walk and fellowship with the Father, with the Son, and with the Holy Spirit. And that these are now the last days. And you need to understand time is wrapping up. And you need to understand now that you need to know for a sure fact that you are saved and delivered from the penalty and the death of sin, and that in these days you're going to have to endure to the end. Looking at Matthew chapter 24, verses 13 through 14 in the Amplified, hear me. It says, "But he who endures to the end will be saved." And this good news of the kingdom, the gospel, will be preached throughout the whole world as a testimony to all the nations, and then will come the end. And so we're not at the end, but we are approaching the end. And because we are approaching the end, your attitude and your lifestyle has to change now to the purpose that you're waiting on the Lord Jesus Christ to appear so that you can now move from death into life, move from physical life into spiritual life, move now into the kingdom of the Lord Jesus Christ because you endured to the end. Hear me today. And then in preparation for the end time, we see the Savior and Messiah states in Matthew 24, 24 through 25. Matthew 24 through 25, it says, "For this, for false Christs and false prophets will arise, and they will show great signs and wonders, so as to deceive and lead astray, if possible, even the elect, God's chosen ones. See, I have warned you beforehand." These are the words from the Master himself, the Lord Jesus Christ. He said to us, and I want you to understand that everybody that's in the pulpit has not been appointed or anointed by the Spirit of God.
Amen.
Everybody that's talking to you has not been programmed by the Word of God. And therefore, today it is my task to warn you that you must keep alert and be prepared for what the end times are going to bring. Today, we want to look at God's perspective of the end times and its preparation to prepare saints for the onslaught of demons, seducing spirits, and doctrines of devils, who are speaking lies of hypocrisy, having their conscience seared with the hot iron, and to declare this message that the real preachers of Jesus Christ must prepare the people of God to battle against the onslaught of wolves in sheep clothing. According to Matthew chapter 7, verse 15 through 16, listen to me very carefully. It says to beware of false prophets who come to you dressed as sheep. Hear me, but inside they are devouring wolves, according to Ezekiel 22 and 27. You will fully recognize them by their fruits. That's what I said. You will surely recognize them by their fruits. Do people pick grapes from thorns or figs from thistles? The Savior and Master of our souls has warned us as saints to prepare for this battle inside the circles of ministry. False apostles, false prophets, false teachers, and false evangelists. The Bible says we need to be fitted with the whole armor of God to quench the fiery darts of the wicked. And I want you to understand today that this is a time of preparation. Let me say that again. This is a time of preparation. And again, the definition of preparation is to be a proceeding to provide one's purpose to do something that you know must be right and not wrong. We're living in a time now where we are in a church, but the church has to be in you.
That's it.
Hear me today. So you must be prepared to understand what the ministry really is all about by telling us that the true nature of these false leaders will show themselves as enemies of the church and the kingdom of the Lord Jesus Christ. And they also will be revealed by their actions, by their fruits, you shall know them, according to Matthew chapter 7, verse 16. In other words, what they're really saying, is it going to lift your spirit? Is it going to give you insight to repent? Mm-hmm. Is it going to bring you to a place where you understand the word of God, or will it lead you somewhere else? So, listen to me today. These are preachers in the pulpit who are leading countless millions away from the biblical truth that the Father sent the Son to redeem mankind from sin by his blood on Calvary's tree. Matthew 1:21 says, "And she shall call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins." And you know what John 3:16 said, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have eternal life." Then the wolf in sheep clothing is someone who hide malicious intent under the disguise of kindness. And I want to quote to you from Zephaniah chapter 3, verses 3 through 5. Zephaniah chapter 3, 3 through 5. This is what it says in the Old Testament. Her officials in the midst of her are roaring lions. Her judges are evening wolves. They gnaw not the bones on the morrow, for nothing is left by morning. Her prophets are light, lacking truth, gravity, and steadiness, and men of treachery. Her priests have profaned the sanctuary, defrauding God and man by pretending their word is God's word. They have done violence to the law. This is found in Zephaniah chapter 3, 3 through 5. And I want you to understand today that the purpose of preaching is to bring the gospel of good news, the birth, the death, and the resurrection and the coming again of the Lord Jesus Christ to save all of mankind, past, present, and yet future.
Right.
And I need you to understand today that we need to know who is talking to you from the Bible standpoint of view. Therefore, the wolf Can and do represent Satan as well as the lion, according to 1 Peter 5 and 8. This is what he said: be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour. Here we see a lion also represents the devil. But guess what? It is a phony. It is a substitute. The real lion is the lion of the tribe of Judah, and that is the Lord Jesus Christ. And so we see now that the devil is in the church. The devil is in the pulpit. The devil is in our music. And now you understand why so many musicians now are turning from church back into the world. Why? Because they were never in the church at all in the first place. They were only there for a moment. And I need you to know today that we need to understand what is really happening in the church and who really is on the Lord's side. This explains why false prophets, false apostles, false teachers hope that they can successfully conspire against God and his only begotten Son and their kingdom of righteousness through what? False doctrines and false teachings, which are carried out through television, radio, internet, and publishings, and evangelistic efforts at the cost of millions of dollars to distract you, to deter you, and to turn you around. I need you to know today that we need to be alert and to prepare ourselves by knowing the Word of God for yourself. What should the church, according to Matthew 16 and 18, as founded by the Lord Jesus Christ, be prepared to fight? 1 Timothy 6 and 12, against, and listen to me, and accepting counterfeit preachers and false Christian leaders as real gospel preachers are sent by the Lord Jesus Christ to bring salvation, healing, and deliverance to mankind. My sermons have not been to send me your money. My sermons have not been that I want a big house or a fine car. My sermons is concerning your soul and transforming your mind to be renewed by the things of God. And so now you understand why we need to know who is in your pulpit. Listen to me. When we speak of counterfeits, we think of not being genuine. They look close like we do. Their portrait is like we, but they're imposters, pretenders, unreal, and someone passed off fraudulently. They are in our national and local churches today looking good, but giving out bad advice. And this is why today I want to talk to you, because we're on the eve now of what everybody is celebrating, and you and I both know that's Halloween. But I want you to know that Halloween is not a Christian standard. It is not a Christian holiday. It belonged to demons and to the devil. And so you need to know that while people are trying to placate and pacify people, we need to tell them the truth and let the truth bear and make them free. What are men and women of God to do today to prepare for the end time? And that is to preach the gospel of good news concerning the eternal God of heaven, who sent his only begotten Son to save mankind from their sins and to make us his disciples and induct us into the kingdom of the Lord Jesus Christ. This is why you need to hear the real preacher, whether it be a male or female. They need to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. And to make us aware from the Holy Bible, all 66 books, there are no books that are preferred before one another. You need to read the whole Bible, that the truth of God's word will come forth. And we know now that Satan is trying to destroy the church, not from outside, but inside. Not from the pew, but from the pulpit. And so I need you to know today that this is the time now to warn you, to keep you alert, to prepare you to understand that you need to know the real deal. The truth of God is to repent, to seek forgiveness, and to claim the blood of Jesus upon your life. Otherwise, we're just living a lie, sitting in church on our way to hell. Listen to me today. I want you to understand that we are now preparing you to know the truth. And the Bible said the truth will make you free.
Amen.
Here we know today that most folk in the church are not warned and they're under false pretense. It is not about singing. It is not about shouting. It's about understanding the principles of God's word to live the life of a godly saint in a cruel, dark world.
Yes.
Listen to me today. We must prepare the saints and warn them about the wolf's approach to destroy the word of God and making it of none effect and causing it to become of no use to save, to heal, and to deliver. According to Psalms 107 and 20, which I quote all the time, the Bible says he sent his word to heal, to deliver, and to bring out of destruction. So my task is to let you know now that you need to study the word of God for yourself.
Yes.
Don't even take my advice. Look it up for yourself and see what God is saying to you so that your heart and mind can be stayed on the things of God. Listen to me today. Simply because wolves are preaching prosperity and wealth instead of salvation through the Lord Jesus Christ. What about your soul? For the Bible said, what profit a man to gain the whole world and lose his soul?
Yes.
So you have a beautiful house. So you have a wonderful car. So you have a wonderful wardrobe. But you're lost and on your way to a devil's hell. But guess what? Devil's hell is only temporary. The Bible said the final judgment is the lake of fire. That will be forever and ever. There's no second chances to come out. And so the best thing for you to do today is to be prepared to understand that you want to be saved, delivered, and set free by the word of the living God. So, how are they gaining entrance? These false prophets, these false apostles, these false teachers, these false pastors. Apostle, how are they gaining entrance? Well, all of this is under the spirit of camouflage, which is used to get as close to the church and its leadership without being suspected as of being demons and devils for destruction and preaching the gospel of shame and immorality. What we see in this case of preparation, and hear me today, in the church, it needs to be made aware that the enemy's camp is not on the outside of the church, but invested and entrenched within the very halls of power. Now we have people in the pulpit lying to you. And unless you know the word of God for yourself, you will fall into that pit. Listen to me today. In this case, we see false preachers with what every position they're holding of the moment, archbishops and prophets and prophetess, popes, cardinals, and any other title that is not biblical or godly and not mentioned in the Bible are disguised as sheep. But what they really are wolves in sheep clothing, and they really are wearing the enemy's uniform belonging to Satan's dark and dreary kingdom. And the only thing that Satan wants is you to be a companion because he's already judged. His judgment will not be changed.
Amen.
I want you to understand today, this parable shows that there will be false prophets, false Christian leaders who will appear to be followers of God. According to Matthew chapter 7, verses 21 through 22, can I talk to you today?
Okay,
the most likely place for these leaders, false leaders, will appear is inside the churches that are preaching the total gospel of good news and the work of Jesus Christ. I need you to know, we need to know now who you are listening to, whether or not it's to bring conviction, whether or not it's to bring reproof, whether or not it's to bring correction, or are you just willy-nilly going to what people are saying without looking it up for yourself? I came to share with you what you already are seeing in the churches today that are in your city, that are on television and around the world. The church is being invaded by false leaders speaking for Christ, but they're not accepting him as their Lord and Savior. Neither are they living a godly life before God's people. I want to quote to you today from 1 John chapter 4, 1 John chapter 4, verses 1 through 3. And I want you to hear me today. Those of you that need to mute your phone, please mute your phone. Amen. Mute your phone. Thank you, Jesus. The Bible says in 1 John chapter 4, 1 through 3, Beloved, do not put faith in every spirit, but prove, test the spirits to discover whether they are processed or proceed from God. For many false prophets have gone forth into the world. By this you may know, perceive, and recognize the Spirit of God. Every spirit which acknowledges and confesses the fact that Jesus Christ, the Messiah, actually has become a man and has come in the flesh is of God, has God for his source. And every spirit which does not acknowledge and confess that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh, but would annul, destroy, sever, or disunit him, is not of God, does not proceed from him. This non-confession is the spirit of the Antichrist, of which you've heard, that is and was coming, and now already in the world. Saints, I can tell you something today that you need to understand. The wolf has only one relationship with the sheep, and that is a short one, usually called dinner. The wolf is there to deceive. The wolf is there to bring you out of the faith. And I need you to understand today, and I want you to hear me very well. You need preachers today that's going to tell you the truth, whether you like it or not. Listen to me today. Although the wolf is in this parable dressed like a sheep, it has no intentions of becoming a sheep. Amen to the power of God. Amen. But what about the wolves within the church? Listen to me very carefully. There are no instructions to remove the wolves from the church except by the word of the living God. And that's why we need students and not just followers. Another amen go right there. A student of the word of God, so that you will know whether or not even me today is telling you the truth.
That's right.
And let me remind you of the book of Acts, chapter 17, verses 11 through 12, where the Bereans search the scriptures daily to make certain that it is the word of God the apostle preached.
Right.
I believe the word of God states it this way, and search the scriptures daily, whether those things were so. Jesus knew all of these things were going to happen, and that's why he asked us for a test. Are you prepared for the test of faithfulness today? Listen to me. In the New Testament, according to Matthew chapter 7, verses 20 through 24, is the test that will prepare you for this end time and shaking that is going on in the church. Therefore, the Bible says, therefore, you will fully know them by their fruits. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father who is in heaven.
Amen.
Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name and driven out demons in your name and done many mighty works in your name? And then will I say to them openly, publicly, I never knew you.
All right.
Depart from me. You act wickedly, disregarding my commands. Listen to me today. I don't know about you, but you need a preacher today that's going to convict you and transform you into being a better saint. You need a preacher today that's going to give you the instructions from the word of God and prepare you for what's coming. And I want you to know what's coming is not going to be very good. For we're entering a time now where the Bible proclaims pestilence, earthquakes in divers places, wars and rumors of wars and famines. And I want you to understand that we're living now in a time where you need to know what to do. And that is to prepare yourself and involve yourself in the word of the living God. So how do we prepare for the end time church victory? Listen to me today. To know the Lord Jesus Christ for yourself through the Holy Scriptures of God, both in the Old and New Testament. Listen to what 2 Timothy 2 and 15 in the Amplified said. It said, study and be eager and do your utmost to present yourself to God, approved tested by trial, a workman who has no cause to be ashamed, correctly analyzing and accurately dividing, rightly handling and skillfully teaching the word of truth. This is why today I want you to understand that I'm going to tell you the truth, so help me God, so that you can understand and know that we're living in crucial times.
Yes.
Greed, corruption, homosexuality, and all of these things are coming before us day by day. And you need to understand that God said he made Adam and Eve, not Bruce and Steve. I need you to know today that all of these things are coming before us.
Yes.
They're on television, they're on the radio,
yes,
they're on the internet. And you need to understand that the word of God is prescribing for you now to live a holy life in spite of what others are trying to do. Listen to me what the Bible said. He said in Romans 15 and 4, "For whatsoever was thus written in former days were written for our instructions, that by steadfast and patient endurance and the encouragement drawn from the scriptures, we might have hope, fast to and cherish hope." In other words, what God has written in Genesis, what God has written all the way in the book of Revelation, is to encourage you to hold on in the midst of all that is going on. Can I remind you that in the days of Noah, God gave the earth 120 years to prepare themselves to repent. Instead, the Bible said man was living idolatry. Man was living lasciviously. Man was doing everything that he could do and wanted to do, not realizing that judgment was on the way.
Right.
And I want you to know today that judgment is on the way.
Yes.
And the only way that you can move out of judgment is to move into the church and believe that God so loved the world,
yeah,
that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have eternal life.
Yes.
And so today I want to make sure that you are saved and delivered from the power and the penalty of sin.
All right.
And that you are ready to know that when death comes, when it comes, it will have no effect on you, because absent from the body, present with the Lord. And so today I want to share with you these words of encouragement so you can understand it's time for somebody to tell the truth. It's time for somebody to speak concerning the things of God rather than the things of this world. And so today I want you to know that I want to put my faith in total fact that Jesus Christ is the Son of the living God, sent to the earth, born of a virgin, that you and I might have a right to the tree of life. And that this was found not in the New Testament, but in the Old Testament, according to Isaiah chapter 7 and verse 14. Here we find that Isaiah foreshadows the virgin birth of the Lord Jesus Christ. So there was no man involved sexually with Mary. This was done of the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
So therefore, Jesus' blood is the blood that will sanctify, cleanse, and renew you and bring you back into relationship with God the Father. Hear me today. The prophet Isaiah foreshadows the virgin birth of Jesus in Isaiah chapter 7 and verse 14. And the New Testament book of Matthew and Luke records details involving the birth of Jesus, who was born about 700 years after the time of Isaiah's prophecy, saying that he was born of the Virgin Mary and he is the Son of the Eternal God. Because he's the only begotten Son of God, Jesus Christ literally can be referred to as God with us. And I want you to know that when we call his name Emmanuel, that's translated God with us.
Yeah.
And you need to understand today, you got to get prepared to understand that this world is headed for a fall.
Yes.
This world is headed for destruction. And the only way you can get involved to know how safe you're going to be is to get involved with Calvary's tree and the Lord Jesus Christ. Notice this, Isaiah 7 and 14. "Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will be with child and will give birth to a son and will call him Emmanuel." That again is God with us. The second prophecy I want you to understand is found in the book of Michael, chapter 5, verses 1 through 2. The book of Michael, chapter 5, in the Old Testament, verses 1 and 2. The Messiah shall be born in Bethlehem. Apostle, why is that important? For you to understand now that the Jesus that we're preaching, the Christ, the Messiah, the anointed one that we're preaching, has been predicted by the word of the living God. And God has given us precise scriptures for us to understand that this is the real Jesus and not one that has come according to the hand of the enemy. Mm-hmm. Listen to me in Michael 5:2. There's a prophecy that reveals that Bethlehem would be the birthplace of the Messiah. This prophecy is effective in a simple way. It eliminates all other cities and towns throughout the world as a place in which the Messiah, Jesus Christ, could be born. It narrows all the possibilities into one tiny village just south of Jerusalem. Oh, praise God for his timing and the power of absolute accuracy through the holy word of God that Jesus would be born in Bethlehem. And you and I both know Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John prescribes the very fact that he was born in the city of Bethlehem, the city of David. Finally, throughout the span of the past 27 centuries, from the days of the prophet of Micah up through the present time of 2022, Bethlehem is credited as being the birthplace for the one and only who is widely known throughout the whole world as the Lord Jesus Christ. And so this tells us now that those who are preaching and they're preaching about another Jesus is not the one that is going to save you, is not the one that's going to deliver you, is not the one that's going to set you free. You need to know that the one that is going to save you was born according to the word of God in Bethlehem, and he was born by the Holy Spirit through a virgin by the name of Mary. And I want you to understand today that you're going to have to get back out of fables, get back out of fairy tales, and get back into the word of the living God. And I want you to understand there's another prophecy that is very important for you to understand, and that is found in the book of Genesis chapter 49 and verse 10. That's what I said, the book of Genesis chapter 49 and verse 10. It said the Messiah would come from the tribe of Judah. Mm-hmm. You need to understand that these are very important things for you to know. First of all, he'd be virgin born. Second of all, he would be born in Bethlehem. Third of all, he would come from the tribe of Judah. And Genesis 49 and 10 says the scepter will not depart from Judah, nor the ruler's staff from between his feet, until he comes to whom it belongs, and the obedience of the nation is his. Who is that, Apostle? That's the Lord Jesus Christ. So in Genesis chapter 49, verse 10, Jacob is blessing his 12 sons, and each blessing he prophesies to each one of them. And the blessings now is for them to understand but what is going to happen in their present situation and what is going to happen in the future. And I want you to know Jacob told his son Judah that his descendants would be rulers and that one of his descendants would be the ultimate ruler. Christian theology refers to this to one and only Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whose kingdom will come without an end. Saints, I need you to understand today that Jesus was born 2,000 years after Jacob died. Yet Jesus' ancestry is traced back to Jacob's son Judah in Luke chapter 3, 23 to 24, and in Matthew chapter 1, verses 1 through 16. Today, there are some estimates that claim that there are as many as 2 billion Christians worldwide who are following the teaching of this king and ruler. But I want you to know that if you're going to be one of them, you must follow it to the letter. For Jesus Christ is the soon coming king. And so I need you to understand today that this message today is about being alert and being prepared to understand the real deal in your life. And so now let's look at what the book says. It says the Messiah would be a descendant of King David. That's what I said. The Bible says the Messiah would be a descendant of the King David. We find that in Jeremiah chapter 23, verse 5. Jeremiah chapter 23, verse 5 says, as well as in other Bible prophecies, we are told that the Messiah will be a descendant of King David. And the New Testament books of Matthew, Luke traces back Jesus' genealogy to King David. Some scholars believe that the genealogy in Matthew is Jesus' legal line through his adopted father, Joseph, and that the genealogy in Luke is Jesus' bloodline through Mary. In other words, the Bible is as accurate as it can be. Jesus is a descendant of King David, and the Bible says he will sit on David's throne. And so I need you to know today, in the final thoughts of preparation for end time, you need to know that I need to share with you today that these are the things that are coming up. Do not be afraid. Do not be weary. Understand that you are covered and protected by the blood of Jesus, but you must be aware that this earth is reeling and rocking. Wars are coming. Wars are coming. Destruction is coming. Tidal waves are coming. All of these are coming because the Bible says the earth is desiring for the return of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so I need you to know that that's found in the book of 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 through 18. This is a warning today to make sure you test and know that you are a saint of the Lord Jesus Christ, and that you are now ready for what is going to come, and be prepared to put on the whole armor of God to quench the fiery darts of the wicked. Listen to me today. This is what the Bible said, and I need you to hear me. It said that in the future, the destruction of Damascus in the Middle East has been found in Isaiah chapter 7, verses 4 through 6. When you see that, if you're still alive, you know the Bible is accurate and the Bible is telling the truth. It also says that the Roman Empire will be revived. You found that in Daniel chapter 2, verses 30 through 31, Daniel chapter 8, verses 1 through 12, where the Roman Empire was never really destroyed. It broke up from within. And God said it's going to come back together again. That's the feet of clay that Nebuchadnezzar had in his dream. And then I want you to know that the Bible says there's going to be the rise of a global dictator that is going to rule the whole world. Found in Ezekiel chapter 38 through chapter 39, Daniel chapter 9, verse 26, and Daniel chapter 7. And this will be called the Antichrist. Now I need to prepare you for the coming of our Lord and his government and the kingdom found in Matthew 24 and 42. So be prepared, because you don't know what day the Lord is coming. You have to stay prepared and ready for any instant to be caught up in the air to meet him according to the word of God. I need you to know that the devil will be defeated, and all of his angels and evil men will be cast into the lake that burns with fire. I know Carlton Pearson tells us that there is no hell, but the Bible said hell has enlarged itself. Yes. And that you and I need to know that the Bible said hell will be cast into the lake along with death. And so there is a hell, and you need to prepare yourself not to go. Amen. There's a friend of mine in California, Prophetess Halima, who said, tell hell I'm not coming. And I want you to understand the reason you're not coming is because you're now involved in the work of ministry through the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so if you're not written in the Lamb's Book of Life, hear me today. Hear me today on the 29th of October. You must have your name in the Lamb's Book of Life. Amen. In order for you to know that you're going to be with Christ for eternity. And the best way to know that is that you confess your sins and tell him, Lord, cleanse me, wash me, renew me, and restore my heart, and bring me again into that place where I know that I'm saved, delivered, and set free. Praise God for Jesus Christ, who's preparing you for his return. And remember, he said he's coming for a church without spot, without wrinkle, without blemish, or any such thing. And you are that church. You are going to be the bride of the Lord Jesus Christ, and he's going to take you into a city that he has prepared for you and for me. And so I need you to know, since we don't know when he's coming, should you be prepared? Since you know neither time, nor day, nor hour, should you be ready? And the only way to be ready is to stay in the Lord's side.
Amen.
Listen to me, according to Matthew 24, 36 through 37, Matthew 24, 36 through 37, Jesus explains that no one knows the hour or the day, but God the Father himself has put this in his own hands. And so what I'm saying to you today is keep alert, stay prepared, learn to know and hear the voice of the living God for yourself. When he speaks, he will speak to you in your heart, and he will transform your mind and keep you alert in perfect peace. But you got to keep your mind stayed on him. And so today I want to close this message with you to understand this. And I need you to hear me today, because this is important. I don't want to yell. I don't want to scream. I just want to talk to you to let you know that we are now in a place where there are many false preachers, many false apostles, many false bishops teaching us and telling us things that are not found in the Word of God. And you need to know now, you need to search these things out. I've told you over and over, don't even take my word. Look it up for yourself, chapter and verse, and find out for yourself what the Spirit of God is saying to you to move forward in life. Listen to me. I need you to know today, as we get ready to close, that there is a place of suffering. And I want you to understand that the Bible said after you've suffered a while, then he's going to establish, strengthen, and settle you. Preachers that are telling you that you don't have to suffer are not in the will of God. Preachers that are telling you that, you can live the life and enjoy life are not in the will of God. For I want you to know, it's going to be some sunshine, but it's going to be some rain.
Yeah.
There's going to be some storms, according to Matthew chapter 7, 24 through 29. And the Bible says the storm is coming, the winds are blowing, the floods are coming. And if you have built your house on a solid foundation, you're going to stand through every storm. And so today I want you to know that this is the time now for you to go back to the word of the living God. This is a time now for you to prepare yourself for what's going to come. It's not going to get better. It's going to get worse. And so listen to me. This is what the book of Romans chapter 10 verses 10 through 11 says. Romans 10, 10 through 11. I want you to read it for yourself. For with the heart a person believes, adheres to, trust in, and relies on Christ, and so is justified, declared righteous, acceptable to God. And with the mouth he confesses, declares openly, and speaks out freely his faith, and confirms his salvation. The scripture says, no one who believes in him, who appears on and trusts in him, will ever be put to shame or disappointed. And so today, if you have not declared with your mouth and believed in your heart that God so loved the world, he sent his only begotten son, this is your opportunity to tell the Lord you want to be saved, delivered, and set free. And once you've been delivered, saved, and set free, you want to live the life that he has brought to you, a sanctified, a holy life.
Yes.
In a cruel and dark world. Now listen to me. 1 John chapter 5, verses 1 through 2. 1 John chapter 5, verses 1 through 2. It says, everyone who believes, adheres to, trusts, and relies on the fact that Jesus is the Christ, the Messiah, is born again child of God. And everyone who loves the Father also loves the one born of him, his offspring. By this we come to know, recognize, and understand that he loves the children of God. When we love God and obey his commandments, his order, and his charges, when we keep his ordinances and are mindful of his precepts and his teachings. And so today, as we get ready to pray, I want you to know that you have been warned. This is your amber alert that things are not going to get better. Things are going to get worse, but in due season, even as God sent ravens to Elijah, he can send ravens to you. I need you to understand, stay in the focus of God's word. Stay in the preparation of prayer and praise. Stay with a song in your heart in the midst of all that you're going through. And know this, he that endureth to the end, the same shall be saved. And so this is the Apostle Ellie Anderson saying to you, I believe today that it's time for us to take the gospel into every hamlet, every province, every nation, and tell them that Jesus is on his way back. And in order for you to know that he's coming back, you must be prepared by being saved and delivered by his blood on Calvary's tree. Today, I want you to understand that God has chosen you. Why do you say that, Apostle? Because the Bible says, for God so loved the world, and you are a part of the world. What did he do, Apostle? He gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever, that's you and me, believe in him, you will have eternal life. And so as I get ready to pray today, I want you to know that today's message was a day of preparation, a day to prepare for what you and I both know is yet to come, and that is destruction on the land. You've already seen violence throughout the world, and I want you to know it's not going to get better, it's going to get worse, but in the meantime, you need to know if you are anchored in the Word of God, you're going to stand through every storm. Listen to me today as I pray. I pray that you get prepared to know for sure that salvation is what you need, that deliverance is what you want, and that you need to know that he's able to keep you in perfect peace as long as you keep your mind stayed on him. So again, now listen to me very carefully. What are you saying, Apostle? I'm telling you now to prepare yourself to be involved in the church and out of the church into the kingdom of the Lord Jesus Christ by being a person who knows that the times are short and that the enemy is doing everything he can to captivate people through the pulpit and through messages of false prophets, false apostles, and leaders that are leading people out of the will of God. But I want you to know today, my job is to lead you back into the place where you say, yes, Lord, and give him the glory for bringing you through another day. Father, in the precious name of Jesus, hallelujah. We come today with the preparation of the word that you've given us to prepare the people of God, that there are wolves in the pulpit ready to devour and to choke out the word of God. But today we rebuke the hand of the enemy and we cast the devil away. We ask you in the name of Jesus to open the faculties of our mind and give us the understanding to know that we must cling to, search for, and believe the total word of God as found in the book beginning with Genesis and ending in the book of Revelation. You've given us 66 books to praise you, to bless you, and to bring us into a place where we have victory in our lives. And so today we thank you for the sermon of preparation on the end time, on the 29th day of October. You're preparing us to know that the word of God will stabilize us and keep us in perfect peace as long as we keep our minds stayed on you. So help us to understand and know that we need to hear from men and women, boys and girls that have been appointed and anointed to preach the word of the living God, to bring us in correction, to bring us into reproof, to bring us into the place where we understand and know that it's time now to shake off the things of the world and to put on the things of the living God. Help us to put on the whole armor of God to quench the fiery darts of the wicked. Help us to have eyes of preparation to know that the time is short, ears to hear what the Spirit of God is saying, and a heart that is ready to receive the things of God in our lives. Lord, put our feet on solid ground. Oh, my God, for you told us in the song, on Christ the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. And so, Lord, I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. And so today we ask for those that are not saved to give them a heart to decree and to declare with their mouth and to believe in their heart that you sent your son, the Lord Jesus Christ, to save, to deliver, and to set free. Give them a heart to know that they must turn now from evil and turn to righteousness. Give them a heart to know they must turn from darkness to light, because Jesus is the light of the world and we are little lights in the world. So today we pray for an increase in the kingdom of the living God. We pray for an increase in our lives with the word of God. Help us to understand and know time is running out. But because time is running out, we yet have a Savior who has control of all things. So we bless you today. We sanctify you and we hallow your holy name. We give you glory and we give you praise that you are the living and true God. So my God, today we bless you. And we thank you for what you've done in sending your only begotten son into a cruel world who was killed and then he was buried. But he was raised on the third day with all power in his hand. And that power today will satisfy us and bring us into a place called victory. And we give you glory and praise for it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Those of you that are on the conference line and those of you that are on Facebook Live, I just want you to begin to praise and bless God for what he's done for you in your life, how he's brought the Savior to save and to deliver and set you free. Whatever is going on in your life, you can thank him that he has kept you in perfect peace while your mind is stayed on him. So open your mouth right there and give him a praise. Open your mouth right there and give him glory. Open your mouth right there and thank him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Because he loved you enough to prepare you and save you and deliver you and set you free. Hallelujah. God, I praise you. Bless us. Hey, open your mouth today. Don't be ashamed. Give him praise. Give him glory. Open your mouth today and let him know, Father, I thank you for what you've done in my life. Thank you for where you brought me from. Brought me out of darkness into a marvelous light. Brought me out of the doom and brought me into prosperity in the word of the living God. Hallelujah. 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 God, I praise you for healing us. I praise you for delivering us. I praise you for setting us free from the devil's work and bringing us into the work of the Lord Jesus Christ. Come on, open your mouth. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Come on, open your mouth and praise him today on the Sabbath, the day that he ordained, the day that he proclaimed and say, keep it holy. Keep it as a memorial that I've blessed the earth and I'm bringing you peace. My God, peace. My God, peace in your mind, peace in your home, peace on your job, peace in your finance, peace. And he said, the peace that I give you is not of the world. Glory be to God under the ocean. Hallelujah. God, I praise you. I bless you today. I thank you today. I worship you today. My soul is saying yes. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes to your will. Oh, my God. Yes to your way. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, I bless you today. My soul is saying yes. Yes, Lord. Yes to the glory of God. You're bringing us to a place now where we honor. We bless you. We sanctify your name. Hallelujah. Again, this is the Apostle L.A. Anderson, along with Evangelist Francis Anderson and LEPC, saying to you today, this is the day of preparation. This is the day to be prepared, to know that the end is coming, but not yet. But I need you to be prepared by staying on the road of righteousness, staying in the pathway of duty, believing God for whatever it is that you need to keep you in perfect peace. Until I talk to you again on Facebook Live or see you in a special service, this is the Apostle L.A. Anderson saying, go with God. God bless you.